But it is an important topic for the practical as well as for the TD. And it is a very important topic in pain and day out life as well. So who are aspiring for orthopedic postgraduate, definitely this will be a very good talk and definitely it will help you. So to get some important bits out of this talk. What is osteomyelitis? So first I want to define this. This osteomyelitis word is coined by the Melaton in 1834. You just imagine that this is before it was invented. Melaton first coined this term. And root word osteum means is the bone and myelo means it is marrow. So once the bone and marrow both are infected or inflamed, then it is called as osteomyelitis. Itis indicates inflammation. It is the inflammation of the bone and inflammation of the marrow both together, then you will call it as an osteomyelitis. So classification of this osteomyelitis is very important for the prognostic aspect and for the management aspect and to understand the disease as well. So this classification is very useful. So when you take this classification of this osteomyelitis, then it's roughly divided into depending on the age, depending on the duration, and depending on the organism that is infecting, and the method of inoculation of that particular organism, and the site that is involved in the bone, whether it is epiphysis, diaphysis, or metaphysis, whatever the area is involved, that is also really important. So according to the age, you consider that whether it is before 18 months or after 18 months. From 18 months to 16 years and after 16 years. This is the age that is the more important thing. Why is there some important anatomical implication in identifying this age is very important to diagnose the condition and to tell the prognosis of the condition and to tell the involvement of the various parts of the bone. And duration is according to the acute involvement and subacute involvement and chronic. So acute, subacute and chronic. So I will tell you what is acute and what is subacute, what is chronic. Sometimes acute and chronic, already chronic osteomyelitis is existed. Over that again, second flare-up of the disease is there. That is called acute and chronic. And organisms, according to the organisms, it is specific, non-specific and parasitic is there. Specific means that the organism should be cultured in a different strain and different culture media. So then only you will call it as specific. Non-specific means the same culture media, same staining techniques will be used for all the organisms. Any of parasitic, you know the parasitic infections are entirely different. So in the specific, you will see the fungal osteomyelitis, tuberculous osteomyelitis and syphilis. In these, you will use special media and special staining techniques. So that's why those are called specific osteomyelitis. Non-specific means it is a routine organism that is gram-positive and gram-negative infection. Those are leading to the infection of the bone. Those are called as non-specific osteomyelitis. It is a parasitic inflammation. Most commonly it is a echinococcus. That is the most commonly that is involved in this parasitic. And the mode of inoculation, it is through that organism should reach the bone through a particular route. That is also very important. The most common route is the hematogenous route. And second is direct inversion. And third one is spreading from the neighboring focus. Spreading from the neighboring focus is most commonly seen in the spine, where the Batten's venous plexus and the retroperitoneal lymph nodes are very close to the spine. From there, the tuberculosis infection directly can affect the bone. This is called a neighboring focus that is infected. And a hematogenous infection, where do you get this hematogenous infection? Suppose you take the children, either in the tonsil or a boil or in the newborn, you will get from the umbilical cord infection. So all these areas, you will get the aseptic focus somewhere in the body that is carried away by the blood and that will be deposited into the bone that will produce the infection that is called hematogenous. Direct inversion, it is most commonly seen in the adult osteomyelitis. Direct invasion means there is a post-traumatic infection. The bone is exposed. It is compound fracture where the bone directly exposed to the environment, where that organisms are directly inoculated on that fracture site. That is one. And post-surgical, once you are operating on the fracture and you are implanting the implant, and if that surgery is infected, then that will lead to the post-surgical infection. These are all directly you are inoculating into the fracture site. So that is called, this is most commonly seen in adult ophthalmology. So hematogenous spread most commonly seen in children, direct invasion most commonly seen in the adult, and the spread from the neighboring focus, both are equally affected. And spine is the most common area where you will get this neighboring focus that is infecting that area. And site of lesion. This osteomyelitis, sometimes you can see it at the epiphysis, you can see it at the metaphysis, and you can see it at the diaphysis. But out of this, which one is very common? The very common is the metaphyseal location is the most common, and why I will explain later. And diaphyseal osteomyelitis, if you see it, that will give you a clue, a particular organism only that is infecting at the diaphysis. And epiphyseal involvement, a particular age group is only affecting the epiphyseal involvement, and particular organism is directly affecting that area. So that will give you the clue, the organism, type of organism, and the age of the patient. These are two are directly related with the site of the lesion. So this is very important. Depending on the duration. So acute osteomyelitis, it is less than 2 weeks of infection. You will call it as acute osteomyelitis. It is between 2 to 6 weeks. And if the host defense mechanism is very strong, that will block the microorganism. So the clinical picture is not that much acute. They don't present with high fever and other acute inflammatory symptoms. They are immune, and they can resist the organism for a longer period. These are called subacute. So in these subacute osteomyelitis, infection usually it is a localized area. Localized areas, just like a Brody's abscess and Garrett's pleurisy osteomyelitis, all these will come under this subacute osteomyelitis. In olden days, this Garrett's pleurisy osteomyelitis and Brody's abscess, these are all come under chronic, but nowadays they are called as a subacute osteomyelitis. And the chronic osteomyelitis, if the infection is persisting in the bone and it is lasting for more than 6 weeks, that means it will keep their telltale marks in the bone, and that clearly it will show you the chronic osteomyelitis picture, that is after 6 weeks only. So then that is called as chronic osteomyelitis. So duration is acute less than 2 weeks, subacute is 2 to 6 weeks. If it is more than 6 weeks, you will call it a chronic osteomyelitis. So, how the organism reaches? I explained, in children, mostly it is because of the hematogenous spread from a septic focus that is there within the body, and these hematogenous spread can lead to any place in the body. It can infect the vertebral bodies, at the same time it can infect the metaphyseal areas, diaphyseal areas, and any area it can affect. And direct inoculation, usually penetrating injuries and surgical contamination, the site where the fracture is seen, there only you will see that infection of that particular bone. So it is a localized one in adults. In a children, it is a disseminated one. This is a very important thing. So the more constitutional symptoms, more debilitating disease seen commonly in the children, but in adults, because it is a localized area, the localized management can suffice, and it is very difficult to manage because the organisms are from external environment directly goes in there. So multiple organisms involvement is more common in direct inoculation. And contiguous spread, it is most commonly it is a vascular problems where the vascularity is very weak and very neighboring infections that can spread the osteomyelitis to the neighboring bone. Most commonly it is a vertebral osteomyelitis. So etiological organisms, I already discussed, it is a specific and non-specific. We are not going to discuss about the specific osteomyelitis, but now we are going to discuss about the non-specific osteomyelitis, and which is very common day in and day out. So in this, what is the organism that is affected? So in the infants, it is below age group that is less than 16 months, and infant means it is only 12 years, but some particular anatomical variations are there, the, because of the blood supply that is going to the bone, that is, that gives you what is the perfect organism that is occurred in implants. Is most common organism is beta hemolytic streptococcus, then it comes to the Staphylococcus aureus, and E. coli is the most common in infants. The children from 1 year to 4 years, it is most commonly it is the H. influenza, but the H. influenza is eradicated because of the vaccine. And now it is the Staphylococcus aureus is most commonly occurring organism in all hematogenous as well as otherwise contagious spread and other things. Also, Staphylococcus organism is the most common thing. Of all these organisms, you please remember this, whatever organism starts with S, that means Staphylococcus, beta hemolytic streptococcus, and all these organisms are highly virulent, first point. And second thing is, disseminated infection is commonly seen with this. The organism starts with S. And another important thing is, the organism that is starts with S is usually bilateral involvement is commonly seen. That is commonly, it is a Salmonella infection. That is commonly that affects bilateral involvement. Salmonella. So, and these are all associated with sickle cell diseases, associated diseases, sickle cell. So, starts with S letter is very important, and bilaterality, sickle cell, and very severe inflammation is mostly seen with the organism starts with S. If the organism starts with P, P indirectly that gives you the clue, it is a penetrating injury. Penetrating injuries means it is a drug abuser, and thorn pick, any pricking, those will give you this penetrating injuries. These penetrating injuries will give you what are the organisms. Those are most commonly is the, those are also start with P, that is Pseudomonas and Pneumococcus. These are the two things that because of the penetrating injuries. So P stands for penetrating injuries, and drug abusers also you will see this Pseudomonas infection very commonly there. So in the drug abusers also you will poke the vein. So that means it is also a penetration. So penetrating injuries, letter P indicates Pseudomonas and Pneumococcus. So how the anatomy is very important. You can see this anatomy. The blood goes through the nutrient reservoir, and it goes to the artery, goes to the metafascial area. Once artery goes to the metafascial area, there is a multiple arterioles. Those arterioles connected with the venules, and through the venules, it is again, it is draining out. So, because through this, before 1 year, there is an epiphyseal growth plate is there. Before 1 year, in an infant, or up to the 16 months of age group, these arterioles will cross the growth plate and it can supply the epiphyseal location. You can see this. Another separate supply is there to the epiphyses. Here it is the arterioles that are crossing. It is before 16 months. Directly these metaphyseal vessels crossing the growth plate and it is supplying the epiphyses. Any infection at this place, directly it can involve the epiphyses. So that's why the entire epiphyseal involvement, metaphyseal involvement, and the diaphyseal involvement commonly seen if osteomyelitis occurs in infants. So if it is more than 16 months, so most of the times the epiphyseal blood supply, that is blood vessels from the metaphyses that are not crossing the epiphyseal growth plate, and those are not supplying the epiphyse. So there is a separate artery that is going there into the epiphyse. So the infection to this area is very, very less, and it is highly vascular. Here, the metaphyseal vessels never crosses the growth plate and it never goes into the epiphyse. So entire infection, whatever lodged in the metaphyses that stays there, it cannot go to the epiphyse. It cannot enter into the epiphyse. That is after 16 months. So after 16 months to 16 years, once after 16 years, this epiphyseal growth plate, there is an epiphyseal closure. Then all the metaphyseal vessels will go up to the epiphyseal area, and that infection can grow up to the epiphyse, the meta epiphyseal junction. So that's why this age is very important. Less than 16 months, it is crossing through the growth plate and it can infect the epiphysis. And up to 16 months to 16 years, there is a growth plate is blocking the blood vessels. So that's why whatever infection is there, that will stay only at the metaphysis. After 16 years, this can go up to the epiphyseal area as well, because there is no growth plate, there is no barrier. So why this metaphysis is more common in these infections? Why this metaphysis? Why this metaphysis means it is highly vascular and the arterioles is having a hairpin band connected with the venules. So that's why whatever flow that is going inside, it is a highly vascular area with sluggish flow. So when the blood flow is sluggish, there is a lot of time is available to organisms to settle there at that particular location. So that's why the more organism, it can settle there. It is between a host and organism. It is a fight between the host defense mechanism and the organism virulence. So if the virulent organism is there, if the more time is there, then definitely it will lodge there and it can produce infection because of the sluggish flow. Another important point here is there is no defensive mechanism at the metaphyseal area. There is no defensive mechanism means reticuloendothelial system is weak at the metaphyseal area. So that's why here you will get infection very commonly, because defense mechanism is not there, but virulent organism that is lodging and it is staying for prolonged period. So if it is staying for prolonged period, that will give you the multiplication of the organism very, very high. The viral load or the organism load will be increased by day by day. For example, you take that there 300 organisms are lodged here. The doubling time usually 3 hours. So within 3 hours, it becomes 600. So within another 3 hours, it becomes 1200. So like that, the doubling time will increase. So by the time 48 hours, the organisms that are settled at the metaphysis will give you enormous number and it can produce necrosis and it will produce a high inflammatory process at the metaphysis. Once inflammatory process starts, it will produce huge edema. Once edema starts, that will lead to the destruction and obstruction of the vessels. So that is the most important cause. This sluggish flow and more stasis of the organism and the defective reticuloendothelial system. And another important factor is, once there is a destruction, the destructive focus will act like a nidus, necrosis. So that can give you the better growth of the organism. And another important thing, once the destruction is started, once the arterioles are blocked, then there is no oxygen supply at that particular area. Once there is no oxygen supply at that particular area, that means whatever mitochondria, whatever defense mechanism is there here, that defense mechanism is lack of oxygen. Once there is lack of oxygen, whatever fighting capacity is there is for the reticuloendothelial system, that is not working properly against the organism. So that's where that leads to the settle down of the infection, microorganism. So one is sluggish flow and long stasis of the organism, and third one is the hypoxia, and the fourth one is the defective reticuloendothelial system at the metaphysis. These are all four contributing why the metaphysis is more common for the osteomyelitis. You can see defective phagocytosis and rich blood supply at the metaphysis, but there is a hairpin band. Because of this hairpin band, there is a sluggish flow and stasis, more stasis of the blood, which is carrying organism. And the metaphyseal hemorrhage, that will produce a good culture media at that area for the organism. The most common mode of infection, as I told you, it is the hemorrhagenous. And in children, metaphysis of the long bone usually affected. The common areas, this is the entrance bit, it is the lower end of femur and upper end of the tibia is the commonest and most commonly involved. But in adults, I already told you, it is the thoracolumbar spine that is commonly involved. So septic focus must be there somewhere in the body to carry that to produce the hematogenous, that is tonsillar infection, skin infection. And the direct introduction, that is by the pinprick and injection and infection, surgical site and open wounds. These are all responsible for adult ophthalmology. This one is responsible for children, osteomyelitis, hematogenous. Direct spread from the nearby infection in the both groups, it is equally effective. So this is classically the hairpin band of the venules, and this is the growth plate that is blocking it. And there the stasis, you will see the stasis at that area. Here it is, how it is happening and what is the time that is taken to produce this infection. That gives you what are the investigative modalities you can ask. So if you know the pathogenesis, indirectly that pathogenesis will give you what are the investigations that are required and what are the useful investigations you can ask. So here it is, once the organism is settled down here at the metaphysis, so it will multiply and it will produce abscess. So within 24 hours, you will get the edema of the tissue and the inflammatory signs you will see. After 48 hours, the abscess is formed and pus is collected and subperiosteally, and it lifts the periosteum. Here, the most important anatomical point is this periosteum is having two layers. One is inner cambium layer and outer fibrous layer. The inner cambium layer is having good oxygenic potential that will produce newborn. That newborn is the involucrum. Once this periosteum is elevated, the inner cambium layer is stimulated and that will produce a newborn. So that is called involucrum. And once the destruction is produced, there will be a necrosis of the bone. That necrosis of the bone will produce a dead tissue within the bone. That dead tissue is called a sequestrum. Here the capsule is attached to the epiphysis. So this is the weakest point where it can go out, because superiorly growth plate never allow the infection to spread into the joint, and inferiorly the metaphyseal area never allow it to go down, but the weakest area through the Haversian system, that infection is traversed through that and goes to the outer cortex and it lifts the periosteum. Once the periosteum is lifted, it will produce involucrum. Through the periosteum, it will produce a sinus pore, and that will discharge the entire pus outside. All these process will take place for 2 weeks. Why I'm saying this? Pus formation, you will see 48 hours. Inflammatory process, it will take 24 hours. And after 2 weeks, you will see the sequestrum dead bone formation. So all these timing is also very important. Which investigation will detect the perfect diagnosis? So this also is simply depicting the same thing. So blood vessels are blocked. Thrombosis, you will see the thrombosis of the hairpin bend vessels. Because of the thrombosis of those vessels, it will produce anoxia at that local site, hypoxia. So pathology, you can see this, same thing. Radiologically, you can visualize this. So involucrum is the sheath of reactive newborn, immature bone, and subperiosteal bone that forms around the sequestrum. Once the bone is formed and around the sequestrum and effectively sealing it off, the bloodstream just like a wall of the abscess. The involucrum is the irregular bone. It is not the regular bone and it is perforated to allow the pus to come out. That perforations are called cloaca. The hole is there in the involucrum, those are called cloaca. So if you know this pathology, this is more than enough. That will tell you everything about osteomyelitis. There is an endothelial branches and infection and acute inflammatory response due to infection. It is seen in the 24 hours. This is best detected within 24 hours by the PET scan. If the tissue necrosis that leads to the tissue necrosis and breakdown of the bone, that is best detected with the MRI and bone scan within 48 hours. And because of this obstruction of the vessels, that will lead to the avascularity of the bone, then indirectly it leads to the avascular necrosis of the bone, that is best identified with the X-ray and ultrasound at the 7 to 14 days. And at the same time, you can use the MRI and bone scan as well. So once sequestra is formed, sequestra is best diagnosed by the CT scan. Best diagnosed by the CT scan, that will be seen at 2 weeks. And chronic osteomyelitis, when you say, if you don't treat it properly, all the sequestrae is dislodged from the parent bone, that means it is the bone, that is the dead bone is living within the living bone. That is the sequestrae, is the hallmark of the chronic osteomyelitis. That is commonly seen after two months, sequestrae. But that is detached from the normal bone. Up to 2 weeks, two months, this sequestrae is with the parent bone. But after 2 months, this sequestrae that is detached from the parent bone and it is floating in the alveolucrum, that is newly formed bone. So what are the presenting complaints in this? Most of the time, the first and foremost sign is the fever. Most important clinical sign is the fever. And all inflammatory signs, you will see that, like redness, erythema, local rise of temperature, swelling, and all are classical signs. And the child never allow the limb to move, that means pseudoparalysis. And the point of tenderness at the metaphysis is a very important clinical sign that will tell you. And if there is an abscess is already formed, you will find the fluctuation. So these are all classical signs. And investigations, how do you diagnose this? Blood pictures, ECDC, ESR, CRP and blood. And CRP and ESR, they are always raised. And CRP and ESR can be used for the prognostication of the effectiveness of your management can be assessed with the CRP and ESR. And total count is more than 20,000, usually it ranges. And if you take the blood culture and gram stain, that will give you the affecting organism. So this is very important. But once you do the culture, it is only 50% of the people will have a blood culture positive. 50% only. X-ray is, you see there is a periosteal reaction. That is the earliest sign you see in the osteomyelitis. But soft tissue shadow obliteration you will see 48 hours. But that is not a good sign. But periosteal reaction and the periosteal elevation and some amount of newborn formation subperiosteally, that is seen at the 7 to 14 days. So by the time 7 to 14 days, already infection is settled totally within the metabolite. And ultrasound can give you a good approach. Within 3 days, it will give you some amount of pus formation and it can detect the variation in the normal bone and the necrotic bone. And needle aspiration is the most important thing. You can use the 16 to 18 gauge needle and you can directly pass it over the metaphyseal area where the maximum tenderness is there. Then you can aspirate the material from that area and you can culture it and you can do the gram stain. In the gram stain and the normal high power field examination, if the neutrophils are more than 5 per field, it is 97 to 96% definitive sensitive test and specific test. This is a very important point. If the neutrophils are more than 5 under high power field, that definitely tells you it is an infection. So only that infection, what is the organism, that should be cultured and you will know that what is the organism. Then you, according to that, you can go for the treatment. That can be done within 24 hours. You can do it at 24 hours. But yielding capacity is only 50 to 60% only the yielding. So just like a culture, this needle aspiration is also, it is only 50 to 20, 60% positivity. But bone scan, it is within 24 hours, it will tell you gallium and indium specific bone scans if you do it. Within 24 hours, it will tell you whether the infection is there or not. But this is also not specific. It never identifies what is the organism. So if you don't identify the organism, you cannot give appropriate treatment to that particular organism. CT scan is most of the times it is high radiation. One thing, in children, this radiation is not acceptable. And second thing is, it is not a good investigation to detect the acute osteomyelitis, but it is very good investigation to detect the sequestrum. But MRI is a very good investigation, high specificity and high sensitivity. It is up to 92 to 96% of specificity and sensitivity. MRI can detect this. osteomyelitis. But of all this, PET scan is there, PET PET scan. PET scan will detect the osteomyelitis within 4 hours, and it will differentiate the soft tissue infection and bony infection, and it is non-radiation is there, and even the metals or anything is there, it can detect the osteomyelitis. So a PET scan is the investigation of choice, but it is not available and it is costly and very difficult to get the PET scan. The investigation of choice is PET scan. So leukocytosis, more than 20,000, and you have to send them all the blood cultures, and a local aspiration also you can send it for culture, and those are all definitive diagnosis. These will give you the definitive diagnosis. So this chart will give you what are the imaging modalities that will give you for the diagnosis of the osteomyelitis. Computer tomography, CT scan, it only sensitivity is 67 and specificity is 50. Leukocyte scintigraphy, that is bone scan, that is 61 to 84% sensitivity and specificity is 60 to 68. But plain radiography is very, very less. It is 14 to 54% and 68 to 70. The positron emission tomography, this is PET scan. You can see it is 96% sensitivity and the specificity is also is 91, but it is expensive and limited availability. And technetium 99 bone scintigraphy, this is only 82% sensitivity, but specificity is only 25. So out of this chart, you can see PET scan is more valuable, 96 and 91%. Then next one is the magnetic resonance imaging, that is 78 to 90% and 60 to 90%. And next one is the leukocyte scintigraphy. Leukocyte labeled, indium and gallium labeled bone scan, it is around 60 to 80% only. 60 to 80% only. But CT scan, it is only 60 to 50%. 50%. So the investigation of choice is PET scan. So then how do you diagnose this? Because the cultures are only 50% positive and the radiological investigations are positive and those are not available, then what is high index of suspicion is the most important thing and you must treat it very early. So definite diagnosis, if you can able to identify the pathogen from the bone, not from the blood, it is from the bone, if you take the core biopsy, then if it is identified from the bone, it is a definite 100% diagnostic picture. And a probable diagnosis, if you can identify the organism from the blood culture, it is the probable. It can be affecting at the metaphysis or not, we don't know, but it is only probable. Likely, all radiological investigations, they will tell you only it is an osteomyelitis, but they won't tell you what is the positive factor of the osteomyelitis. So, bone biopsy, if you can able to culture it, that is the key diagnosis, that is, you will identify the organism, but it is only 50% chance, only 50%. In probable diagnosis, also blood culture is also 50% chance. But likely diagnosis, if you take the positron scan, definitely it will tell you infection. But with the previous history of what are the infecting organisms according to the age group, so you know that organism, you know that likely diagnosis with the radiological investigations, you can able to identify that process, whether it is infection or inflammation or malignancy. So then you can start your management empirically depending on the organism and infection. So what are the diagnostic criteria? So there is a Peltola Vallerman's criteria is there. That is first from the bone. And blood culture and bone culture, if they are positive. And clinical diagnosis and radiological diagnosis. So take all the things. If any two is positive, it is definitely 100% osteomyelitis. So remember, the clinical suspicion of the bone and joint infection is important indication for treatment. Whenever there is you suspect the infection, always you have to start your treatment. Why? Because once bone is infected, eradicating the bone infection is a very, very, very dangerous procedure and it takes very long time to eradicate the infection. Why? Because whatever organism is there, that organism is settled on within the osteoblast. In a post-traumatic and a post-operative infection, there is a biofilm is forming over the bone and bone metallic substances where the organisms can settle down within the biofilm. That biofilm is because of the glycocalyx. That is called glycocalyx, most common asking entrance bit. So within that, these organisms will settle down, they live dormantly for a prolonged period. Once the host defense mechanism is weak, they will come out and again they will produce infection. So all these organisms will settle down within the osteoblast and they are settled down within the biofilm that is called glycocalyx. So if you're able to differentiate this problem from others, that is acute septic arthritis. Septic arthritis means that itself says it is not osteomyelitis. It is in the joint. So this is one of the important differential diagnosis. Why? Because some of the metaphysis are within the capsule. So most common site for the osteomyelitis is the metaphysis. Once infection at the metaphysis, if that part of the metaphysis is within the capsule, that means that part of the metaphysis is within the joint. So that part is infected, then automatically entire joint will be spoiled by the infection. That will important and dreaded complication of the osteomyelitis is creating a septic arthritis. Because of the metaphysis that is lying within the capsule. And acute rheumatoid arthritis, this is not that much. And survey, another important thing is commonly seen in the children due to vitamin D deficiency. Classically, it presents a tenderness, fever, and points towards the area. Mostly, it is over the diaphyseal areas you will see this. And acute poliomyelitis, this is commonly a muscular problem rather than a bone problem. Antibiotics. How do you treat this? If you see this infection, if you identify it, if you have a suspicion of it, is there? If you have a suspicion of that, it is there. Acute osteomyelitis, immediately you have to start with the parental antibiotic. Empirically, you know the organism, it is a Staphylococcus aureus is the most common organism. So you have to tackle that. If the site is less than 1 year, a gram negative organism is also very common, like E. coli. So gram positive and gram negative organisms must be covered. It should be in the intravenous route. So whatever antibiotic you are giving it, it should be bactericidal. It should not be the bacteriostatic, one thing. And always you have to maintain the MIC levels more than 8 times of the normal MIC levels. 8 times of the normal MIC levels. This is a commonly asking entrance rate. You have to use 8 times of the normal MIC levels. So that's why you have to maintain intravenous antibiotics only that will reach that area. So that is 2 weeks for intravenous antibiotic and 6 weeks for oral antibiotic you have to take. CRP and ESR, I already told you, these are all the things for the monitoring the response of the treatment. The best antibiotics are combination is the triazole and vancomycin combination is the best dose in acute osteomyelitis in children. So when you operate in these patients, I already told you, in the inflammatory process is only within the 24 hours. After 48 hours, in spite of you are giving intravenous antibiotics, if the patient is not responding, the fever is continuing, TRSC is also raising, ESR is also raising, then edema is also increasing, then you have to go for aspiration of the pulse and you have to do the surgical drainage. That means where the fluctuation and abscess is there, you aspirate it. And you do the multiple drill holes at that metaphyseal location and you allow all the pus and the necrotic debris to come out by the surgical drainage. So this is a important thing. If the patient is not responding after 48 hours, 48 hours means pus is already formed. Once the pus is there, whatever antibiotic is you are giving it, it never reach the site, infected site. So that's why after 48 hours, only surgical treatment is the choice. So if you don't treat like that, then what will happen? the commonest complication of acute osteomyelitis is the chronic osteomyelitis. You are converting this acute osteomyelitis into the chronic osteomyelitis, the most common complication and most dreaded complication. You never get healing of this. You cannot eradicate the organism from that location. So the early the treatment, the early the result, and that is the best prognosis. So the best thing is IV antibiotic. If you suspect it, drain it. Acute pyogenic osteoarthritis, I already told you, septic arthritis is a very important complication, most commonly seen at the hip joint and shoulder. These two are very important joints, and these joints, metaphyses are always some part is within the joint. Pathological fractures, usually once infection is there, the more blood supply. More blood supply leads to the more bone turnover at that level. More bone turnover means there is a osteoporosis at that level. Once osteoporosis, there is a weakening of that bone. Because of the destruction, there is a weakening, and ultimately you will get a pathological fracture. Because this infection is nearer to the growth plate, increased blood supply to the growth plate will occur. Once increased blood supply and irrigation of the growth plate, that leads to the stimulation of the growth plate. Once growth plate is stimulated, then that will produce lengthening of the bone. Lengthening of the bone, if it is stimulated. But all, if the infection is crossing through the growth plate, if the infection is settling before 1.5 years, that means before 18 months, then this infection can infect the epiphyseal growth plate as well. Once epiphyseal growth plate is also involved, then it will produce the growth arrest. So you will see the shortening of the bone, and as well as you will see the lengthening of the bone. So once you left it, you don't treat it properly, then ultimately it ends up with a chronic osteomyelitis. The definition, you know that it is 6 weeks. So what is the reason for this? It is, you are not treating. There is no high index of suspicion. So that is the reason for failure. And you are not investigated properly, and you are not treated properly, and you are not planned properly for the management, then ultimately ends up with a chronic osteomyelitis. Chronic osteomyelitis is not a problem with the acute osteomyelitis, which is commonly seen in the children. But chronic osteomyelitis is a major problem. It is a iatrogenic problem. It is either post-traumatic or post-operative infection of the bone. Post-operative infection of the bone that leads to the osteomyelitis most commonly. So that is, Sydney and Madeline, they classified, it is a medullary endosteal disease. Only infection is settled down in the medullary canal where you do the intramedullary nailing of the bone. Once there is a fracture or femur is there, you will do the intramedullary nailing. Intramedullarly, the implant is there. If that implant is infected, you will put the infection in the medullary canal. So outside, only one particle of the bone is affected. That is commonly seen when you do the plating. Once you do the plating, if the plate is infected, then automatically you will get the infection in one cortex of the bone. So that is type 2. If the cortex of the bone is involved and the entire cortex has become necrotic and that infection spreads to the medullary canal, that is called cortex as well as medullary canal is affected, it is difficult to treat. And entire bone is affected and the medullary canal is also infected, it is the type 4. So these are all seen in compound fractures, these two. And this one is seen in the intramedullary nailing, and this one is seen in the plating of the bone. So the chances of eradication of the infection is also in the order. The nailing infection can be easily eradicated than the plate, and the plate infection can be easily eradicated with the localized tissue loss. If the entire tissue is infected, it is very difficult to treat. So this is the examination point. What are the points in favor of your diagnosis? Suppose the case comes to you in the exam. Very routinely you will get this. The history. Classically, they will give you a history of the fracture, history of the operation, or history of any inoculating thing. And symptoms, most of the times, it is a waxing and waning pattern. Today, patient is absolutely good. Suddenly, they will develop a small fluctuating swelling. Once that fluctuating swelling is bursted, and it will produce a sinus, and it will produce a discharging pus. And once you see that, there is an undermining ulcer. and the irregularity of the bone is there, because involucrum is formed, new bone is formed, irregularity is there, and the thickening of the bone is there, because now once the involucrum is formed, there is a broadening, thickening and irregularity of the bone. Whatever sinus is there, if this sinus is always adherent to the bone, this is the most important point to identify and to say that this is a chronic osteomyelitis. The sinus is completely adherent to the bone, adherent to the bone. This is important. And when you go to the history, classically these patients will tell you that discharging bony spicules through the sinus. Sometimes those people will bring that bony pieces to the ward and they will show you. This is discharging bony spicules is the diagnostic of chronic osteomyelitis. And on palpation, you will see the tenderness and irregular surfaces and thickening of the underlying bone and sinus is fixed. And surrounding movements of the joints are restricted. I already told you, once the pus is there, it is tracked down into the muscular tissue and it will produce myositis and it will produce fibrosis of the muscles. Once fibrosis of the muscles happens, that leads to the contraction of the muscles. Then that leads to the restriction of the joints which are acting on that. Hallmark of chronic osteomyelitis, I already explained, it is the sequestra. Sequestra is the dead bone living in the living bone which is separated by the granulation tissue. You can see this is the involucrum, outer new bone, and within that there is a dead bone is there, and surrounding there is a big hollow space that is the granulation tissue. So this opening is called, within the involucrum, it is called pleura. Paraparotidally, you will see the involucrum, it is a normal bone. You can see this, but if you see the dead bone, this is the sequestrated bone. It is pale white, a chalky white is there. There is no blood supply to this. But here, the blood supply, once blood supply is there, it appears like this. But here, it is a clear-cut white chalky area. So that is a vascular bone. It is a dead bone. You can see this. A dead bone that is living in the living bone, and this opening is called a cloaca. Radiologically, you can diagnose this. You can see the involucrum, this outer surface is the involucrum new bone, but original medullary canal is this. But you can see a small opening, a sinus or cavity is seen here, that is called cloaca. And you can see a sequestrum, that is hyperdense area within the medullary canal. That means surrounding eucentry, and there is a hyperdense bony part is there within the medullary canal. This is sequestrum. What are the types of sequestra you commonly see? A tubular sequestra, it is because of a pyogenic infection. And ring sequestrum, it is because of the external fixator or because of the amputated stump also, you can get the ring sequestrum. A black one, it is the actinomycosis. And the pyriform, you will see in the Pettis disease. And oak type of and sandy sequestrum, both are in the tuberculosis. And the feathery or ivory sequestrum, you commonly see in the syphilis. Then what is the gold standard for to say that this is the osteomyelitis, chronic osteomyelitis? The gold standard is the biopsy. It is not any other modality of radiological investigation. You must take the biopsy and you have to confirm the organism there. That is, the biopsy is the most important investigation, gold standard for chronic osteomyelitis. So then how do you know that how much part of the bone is infected or not? So there are multiple sinuses you will see. You have to do the sinogram, is one of the important investigations. And isotope bone scan is also, that will tell you whether it is acute and chronic. And CT will provide you the information about the sequestrum. And MRI will provide you the information about the soft tissue. That is the most important thing. What are the other soft tissue involvement is there? And how much amount of the medullary canal extension of the infection is there? That is the best to visualize by the MRI. And the MRI will reveal in a broad is abscess, you will see the rims and I will explain, I will show you. So in the radiologically, you will see this. You can see this, there is a sequestrum within the bone. And there is a dense irregular bone is there. So irregularity, hypertrophy, and broadening, these are all sclerosis and cortical destruction. And the cavities and a periosteal reaction. These are all the classical features of chronic osteomalacia. So chronic abscess previously it is known as the chronic one, but nowadays it is called as subacute osteomyelitis, because in this subacute body defense mechanism is very strong and virulent organism is not there. The organism virulence is less. So that's why that organism is captured by the our defense mechanism, and surrounding it will produce a new sclerotic bone. It never allows that organism to escape out of it. It is a new circumscribed round oval cavity containing pus and pieces of dead bone within that and surrounded by sclerosis. And most commonly seen in the tibia and the femoral metaphysis. This is also entrance to it. And very rarely you will see in the epiphysis. And the metaphyseal lesion has little periosteal reaction, but surrounding area you will get a dense bone. You can see this. A well circumscribed, there is a light lesion within that, and you can see the thick sclerotic rim in the metaphyseal area. This is the classical of Brody's abscess. Here you will see the cortex is thickened, only cortex is thickened, and the medullary canal is normal, and this is subacute osteomyelitis. Once diaphyseal involvement is there in subacute osteomyelitis, this is one of the important differential diagnosis for Ewing sarcoma. Diaphyseal subacute osteomyelitis, one of the important differential diagnosis for Ewing sarcoma. That's why in any chronic osteomyelitis, you must do biopsy to exclude any malignant. The malignancy can mimic like chronic osteomyelitis. So that's why biopsy is the investigation of that. So you can see this rim sign. Rim sign is the MRI finding. If you take MRI, the T2-weighted images, if you take it, or T1-weighted images here, fluid appears black and surrounding marrow appears white. So that means a hyperdense area is there, a hyperdense area and a fluid, surrounding fluid, and infection, necrotic tissue is appears black inside that. This is penumbra sign or rim sign. It is called as penumbra or rim sign. You can see here, this is the necrotic area and surrounding hyperdense area. This is seen in the T1 weighted images. In T2 weighted images or fat suppression studies, you will see that fluid appears white. Fluid appears white and the fat appears dark. The fat suppression studies, fat is suppressed. And outer area is edema. That edema appears white. So this is called penumbra sign or rim sign. Cyanogram, what is the importance of cyanogram? So inject the cyanum, methylene blue, through the sinus. You pass the catheter through the sinus and you inject the methylene blue through the sinus before surgery, 24 hours before surgery. What is the importance of this cyanogram? Once you inject the methylene blue, all the dead tissue will take this blue color and all viable tissues never take this blue color. So that will help you to differentiate what is the dead tissue and what is the viable tissue. So that's why cyanogram is a very important investigation for surgical management. Sinus sacs can be injected with methylene blue 24 hours before surgery to make them easier to locate and excise. So all dead bones become blue and all viable bones become dark. So what are the differential diagnosis between teeth? Tuberculous osteomyelitis is one of the important differential diagnosis for chronic osteomyelitis. In tuberculous osteomyelitis, commonly you see the watery discharge and previous history of tuberculosis is there, and the edges are always undermined, but in chronic osteomyelitis, because of pyogenic infection, it is not undermined and it is stick to that. And the sinus is usually blue color, that is important point, and undermined and watery discharge. And if you see the lymphadenopathy, you will see the sinus. There is a matted lymphadenopathy you will see. But in event sarcoma, in subacute osteoma, that is, if it is involved in the diaphysis, it is a very important differential diagnosis for a event sarcoma. And soft tissue chronic infections, definitely you can identify with MRI. And treatment, it requires multifaceted approach. The first thing is you have to take out all the dead tissue. That means excision of the dead tissue, excision of the sequestrum. And second one, once you excise it, it will give a big gap in the bone. That should be filled with the either bone or with the bone cement or with the muscle flaps. That is the covering of the defect. Once the defect is covered, then over that soft tissue covering is given. And next one is the dead space is filled with the bone graft. These are all three procedures. Any surgical procedure, any infection, drainage first. Once it is drained out, that should be filled with the gap, should be filled. Never allow the dead space. That should be filled with the bone or with the muscle flap. So this is the basics of surgery. You please remember this word, Halstead. Who coined this and who designed, who has given all these things? H indicates handle the tissue gently and leave blood supply intact and strict aseptic you have to form and tension minimize. The edges must be closed in a tension-free manner and edges together nicely opposed and dead space must be managed. Once dead space is left, all the necrotic and serosanguinous discharge is laid on and it will act as a nidus for the infection. Again, infection will resettle. So surgery is only removal of the dead tissue. So once you remove that dead tissue, management is by the bone grafting procedure. And second one is the polymethyl methacrylate. That is, along with the antibiotic loaded thing, you can fill that area. And local muscle flaps and skin grafting, and with or without bone grafting. Local muscle flap, why do you use a local muscle flap? Local muscle flap is having blood supply. Once you keep that local muscle flap into the dead space, that muscle flap will give the blood supply to that dead bone or the local area. So the healing process will be very good because of the blood supply. So that is important thing. And sometimes you can transfer the osseous flap. That means directly the fibula can be transferred directly to that area, which is osseous flap. That is called osseous flap. And use a bone transport procedure, that is ilithro. This is very useful in infections of the TBR. This is an entrance bit. Ilizarov is best useful in infections of. They will give you humerus, femur, TBR. The TBR is the best bone to be treated with Ilizarov. It is destructive osteogenesis. By destructive osteogenesis, by improving the blood supply to the bone, it will control the infection. It will control the infection. Sequestrectomy and curettage in chronic osteomyelitis is the mainstay of management. So you can see this. There is a sinus and there is a big pocket of infection is there. This is a sequestrum. It is a tubular bone. So whatever movement is there, because of the narrow mouth, whatever debris and pus, it never come out. So the infection will stay longer here. So if you remove this particular bone and you make it open, open the mouth of the sinus. If you open the mouth of the sinus, the water fluid that is there within that, it will easily drain out. Once it is drained out, because you are taking this much of bone, the cortex is become weakened. You please see this. Cortex become weakened, there are high chances of pathological fracture. To avoid this pathological fracture, if you want to do the sequestrectomy and partial catheterization, this is called catheterization. Tubular part you are converting into a like a saucer, shallow area. Once it is shallow, no fluid can stay there. It will immediately drain down. So this is called catheterization. Once you do the catheterization, bone becomes weak. So catheterization must be done once a good amount of involucrum bone is formed. Then only you have to do the catheterization. Involucrum is a new bone that is formed in osteomyelitis. That is the normal bone, that is not abnormal bone. So this process is called sequestrectomy process. In examination, definitely they will ask you. This is used for to remove the sequestrant. Passage of time. So how much part of the bone is you want to remove it? You have to remove the bone slowly, 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 5 mm. So once you take out the bone, there is no active bleeding. If you see the punctate active bleeding there, till that appears, you have to take out that much of bone. So that punctate appearance of the bleeding edge of the bone, that is called paprika sign. So it is chili red in color, so that's why they are calling it as a paprika sign. So once gap is there, this gap must be filled with antibiotic loaded polymethyl methacrylate antibiotic loaded chain. So this is the bone cement, otherwise called as bone cement. This is loaded with antibiotic and entire area is filled with this antibiotic beads. These beads will produce local antibiotic that is acting on the infective organism. This will clear the infection, whatever remnant is there. So this will left over there for 2 days, that is 1 month. Then you will take it out. Then again you can do the bone grafting at that local area. So myocutaneous clasp, these are called Belfast technique. What it is called Belfast technique, you take the muscle along with the cutaneous skin. You place it in a gap area that fills entire gap and it never allows the dead space. It never allows the serosanguinous discharge stays there. It never allows the organism to settle down there. So dead space filling is very, very important management part in the chronic ophthalmology. Ilizarov, after doing corticotomy means only cortex is broken, it will leave the periosteum intact and as well as it will leave the medullary arteries intact. So once these two are intact, only cortex is broken, once you do the distraction, it will increase the vascularity of the particular bone. Once it is increased the vascularity of that particular bone, that bone grows. This is called distractive occlusion. Distractive occlusion. Whatever bone is defective, you can lengthen the bone and you can create the bone and you can heal it very nicely. You never get the shortening of that particular bone. So in this, you can control the infection, you can fill the gap and you can get the normal length of the limb. That is the advantage of Ilizarov technique. This is distractive osteogenesis principle. The small double procedures are not required. Once if you use the polymethyl methacrylate, you have to take it off. Otherwise, it will act as a nidus for the infection. So to avoid dosing, second procedure, recently they are designed it is a calcium sulfate and calcium phosphate. These are all bioabsorbable with the antibiotic. So you can keep the antibiotic with the calcium sulfate and calcium phosphate. These will give you local antibiotic area and these will be absorbed by the bone. So if there is no second part surgery in these cases. Adjuvant therapies, these are all not routinely used. It is a hyperbaric action. Because low oxygen at that particular metaphyseal area, that's why the organism is growing better. If you give more oxygen, that local oxygenation, that will improve the fighting capacity of the macrophages and that will improve the local area. And that thing sort of debridement, first you have to do the debridement. Bone morphogenic proteins and plasma, these are all bone inducing agents. So once you apply these proteins at the defective area, that will give you new bone formation. But these are all costly, routinely we are not using it. But completion sake, we are selling this hyperbaric oxygen and bone morphogenic protein. But entrance bit, definitely they will ask you whether these are useful or not. The last one is easy procedure, routinely we do in a routine practice. It is a Papineau technique. Papineau technique is, first is you do the debridement and leave the sauterization. Once it is sauterized, so keep the open bone grafting. You take the electric bone graft, over that, lay the electrode and fill the gap. Then over that, you can do the either muscle pedicle clasp or myocutaneous clasp over that. You cover that area. So that is Papineau technique. First one is debridement. Second one is electrode graft. And last one is the wound coverage. This is commonly done technique. This is called Papineau technique, hold technique. What are the complications of this chronic osteomyelitis? Acute exacerbation and growth abnormalities, shortening, lengthening, and you will see the pathological fracture and joint stiffness because surrounding infection. Tissues are inflamed and they become scarred and they become fibrotic. So joint stiffness. Sinus tract malignancy is a very rare complication, but it is very important. Sinus tract malignancy, that is squamous cell carcinoma, that is called as Marjolin ulcer. This is very important. And muscle contracture, epithelioma, and amyloidosis. These are all common complications. A very important tip, that is mnemonic, APAS. You can remember this complication. APAS means angular deformities of the bone, varus valgus deformities, and P indicates pathological fracture, A indicates amyloidosis, and G indicates growth disturbance, the shortening, lengthening, and unchanging limb, and 5 indicates epithelioma, or nothing but as a is a malignancy of the sinus tract and infection. So APAS is a good mnemonic to say that a chronic osteomyelitis. Thank you.